More than 1 million British and Commonwealth servicemen lost their lives between 1914 and 1918. The war to end all wars touched every family in the country. 90 years on, the shadow of loss still lingers. In a week-long series of remembrance, BBC One is helping some of the country's best-loved television personalities search for their own family war stories. Tonight, actor Matthew Kelly is on a quest to discover how his great-uncle died.
I really need to fill in the details now. I know, and I keep looking at that picture of him and thinking he was here. You know, it makes it all real, doesn't it?
And England cricketer Phil Tufnell experiences what life was like for his grandfather in the Royal Flying Corps.
It's really sort of nostalgic. It's brilliant.
Matthew Kelly is travelling through France on his way to the battlefields of Flanders. He hopes to solve a family mystery.
I'm in search of the story of my Uncle Albert, my great-uncle Albert, who was my grandma's older brother, the oldest of seven, one boy and six girls. And all we know about him is he finished up in a prisoner of war camp in 1917 where he died. He was the only boy of seven children killed, you know, and what he did to that family. And why do I know nothing about it? I mean, I know it's 90 years later, but it's only like two generations on. I think it's important we should know.
All Matthew knows is that his great-uncle died in a prisoner of war camp in 1917. To find out how he came there and how he died, Matthew must retrace Albert's footsteps through the war. From official records, Matthew knows that 20-year-old Private Albert Nugent, service number 10831, arrived in France just 2 weeks after war was declared. 4 days later, he was fighting in his first major battle. Albert survived, but he was then sent 80 miles north to Ypres in Belgium, and even heavier fighting. Matthew's quest begins at a cemetery there, named after Albert's regiment, the East Lancashires.
There you are, 2nd of November, East Lancs lad, age 19. He's a lieutenant, age 19. He's already, my son is already twice his age. Terrible, isn't it? It must have been a big battle here at that time. Look at all these together. Hang on. Now, look here. He's number 10817, is that? He must have joined just before Uncle Albert, right? He's 10831. And then there's 10868. I bet Albert knew these two. I bet he knew all of them, actually. And he could have been here, putting all their bits in. Oh, God, can you imagine that? So if they weren't digging trenches, they were digging graves. I didn't know he was one of the first here. All I know is that, oh, dear old Uncle Albert, he died in the war, and he was 23. That's terrible. I've already had 35 years worth more life than him. Hey, Albert. Where did you go after this? And was it worth it?
The under mentions NCOs and air mechanics of number 46 Squadron left on the 15th of the 10th, 1916, for overseas.
England cricketer Phil Tufnell's grandfather, William Tufnell, was a mechanic in the Royal Flying Corps.
Where's my old man? Where's my dad? No, there are Tufnell. Tufnell. There's his number. 18709. Well, I didn't know anything about my granddad at all. And so we sent off for his service records and we got them here. And it just really brings it home. It says here, description, civilian occupation, metal worker.
coppersmith up here again, trade cutter. I mean, that's the family business. We were silversmiths. You know, I suppose it's just metalworking and working with your hands. Metal workers and engines and making bits and pieces for the engine and the exhausts and things like that. Person to be informed of casualties, Susanna Emily Tufnell. So I suppose that's if he got shot or something, or blown up or something. I suppose, you know, it's a matter of life and death. I wouldn't have done it. I never met my grandfather, you know. I wished I had, you know.
Phil wants to find out what life was like for William and his squadron, fighting in planes over the fields of the Western Front. Matthew is travelling in the footsteps of his great-uncle, Albert Nugent. He died in a prisoner of war camp in Germany. The son of a police constable from Manchester, Albert was the eldest and the only boy of seven children. With the 1,100 men of the 1st Battalion East Lancashires, he fought in the war's very first battles. Accounts of the casualties were recorded daily. 94 years later, these give Matthew an insight into Albert's war.
From November to March 1915, they lost 24 officers and 1,115 other ranks, which means that the whole regiment at some point, the whole total numbers were replaced completely. And my Uncle Albert apparently was still with them. And he must have been burying them on the way. Blimey. Makes you think, doesn't it? Fighting and burying. If you look at this countryside, you cannot imagine what his journey would have been, what he would have felt, what he would have seen. I can't picture it. It all looks rather lovely. You see loads of cemeteries. I think there's about 300 here. So they're just at the side of the road. And they're rather lovely places.
Matthew has tracked his great-uncle Albert to what is now an industrial estate on the outskirts of Ypres. He's meeting World War I archaeologist Oral Serku, who has spent years digging here. He's found hundreds of objects on land where Uncle Albert's regiment fought.
So you see these poplars over there. To the left of it was the trench where the East Lancashire regiment was.
So he could well have been in these trenches.
Oh, yes, he was there, absolutely. No doubt about that, absolutely.
What are the personal effects that you found?
Well, so these were oxo cubes, and I remember I took them out of the clay and I smelled them, and they smelled delicious, like oxo. Yeah. Not anymore.
The objects Oral has found provide a snapshot of Albert's life on the front line.
Something in the cup with water. Wow. These are fantastically
yes,
well
these
preserved.
These are amazing. They were found too near where the East Lancashire Regiment was. These gloves almost look brand new. And the same for these socks. I remember when I found them that I said, this is not possible, this is not World War I. But afterwards, somebody told me, yes, they did knit like that at the time. It's amazing to feel them.
Actually, you know, part of you thinks it was so long ago and we should forget it all. Why do you think it's important that we should remember it now? And what do you think its value? What do you think the value of this?
Well, each of the men who died here and all the other places along the Western Front makes it worthwhile to continue to remember that, who left a wife and children at home and who came here and who thought of them and who was terrified with all these shells flying over and fearing to be killed any moment.
This was before he went into the Royal Flying Corps. He's at the back there, a demon outside right, he was.
Was he any good at football?
Oh, well. Of course he was. That's how I got my blood and you got your blood. Of course he was good.
Phil Tufnell's dad has unearthed a treasure trove of personal effects from his own father's time in the Royal Flying Corps.
His old watch.
Oh, right.
It's got a bit rusty now. It is 18709. That was his number.
William Tufnell was a 22-year-old silversmith from Finsbury in London when he enlisted in the Royal Flying Corps in January 1916. Just 2 months after marrying Susanna, he left for active service. His skills as a metal worker were in demand, and he was sent to France as a mechanic with 46 Squadron.
That looks like the pilot. He looks a bit posh.
He's the pilot. Yeah, he's the pilot.
He's got a bigger hat on.
Well, not quite that, but my dad would have gone through walls for these people, you know. It took a lot for my dad to make heroes, but these pilots, he certainly had the utmost respect for them.
Yeah, I bet.
Against them, there used to be like, you've heard of the Red Baron?
Yeah.
Well, these blokes used to have to go up against him.
Yeah, my dad said about my granddad that he had a really great relationship with the pilots, and they had a great relationship with all the boys, because it must have been like a big team, you know, and everyone depended on everyone else to do their job, and especially, you know, the pilots, if your mechanic or you hasn't made the plane proper or it hasn't gone right, you know what I mean, or it breaks down in midair, you know, that's your backup. I suppose, you know, it's a matter of life and death, you know, you've got to get yourself up and away, and I wouldn't have done it. Crikey, I wouldn't have done it.
Matthew has enlisted the help of military historian Paul Reed to help him find out how his great-uncle Albert died. Paul has discovered that Albert came here to Mousetrap Farm in 1915. It lay at the heart of the infamous Second Battle of Ypres.
We've got a regimental casualty record here.
He's there.
He's here.
He's there.
There's the number you know so well now. 10831.
Sergeant
Nugent A, shown as admitted wounded on the 13th of May 1915.
Does he say how, why, what, when, where?
Well, if you look underneath, it says he's sent to the 15th Field Ambulance, and they were a medical unit.
Okay.
With a GSW head. Now, that means gunshot wound to the head.
And this is happening, like, yards from here?
Yards from here, and we're literally looking out across the ground where it was. So somewhere out there, Albert Nugent was wounded in the head by a bullet or a piece of shrapnel.
I have no idea. And then he comes back?
He comes back a few weeks later. He's sent to Rouen, which was the main base hospital at that time, and he rejoins his battalion at the end of May.
Two weeks later?
Yep.
Such was the scale of the killing here. Wounded soldiers like Albert were patched up and sent back to the front line. Ypres was one of the bloodiest places to be in the First World War. One in every three men who died on the Western Front died here. A total of 250,000 British and Commonwealth soldiers. The Menin Gate commemorates those lost. Inscribed on its walls are the names of nearly 55,000 men whose bodies are yet to be found. Every evening at 8 o'clock, the town of Ypres remembers all those who gave their lives.
I think because of the day I've had today, that all these people, any of these people, could be him. But they're not. He went on. He did more. And we don't know yet what happened to him, but we will do. And any of these could have gone on. These are our relatives. These are our people.
And they're going down of the sun, and in the morning we will remember them.
Phil is visiting the Northern Aeroplane Workshops in Batley, Yorkshire, to find out more about the planes his grandfather worked on.
Oh my God, look, you can almost... I could almost break that with my finger. Very light. Got like a little wicker chair in here where you'd sit. That must be the fuel tank. Wouldn't take much of a bullet to get that catch fire. And that'd be, you'd be sitting right on top of it, and it looked really cramped inside there. I mean, you can hardly get your legs in there or anything, or move about. Just looks like a model aeroplane.
A team of volunteers are painstakingly building a World War I sop with camel from original blueprints. It ran on motorcycle wheels, and the wings and body were made from timber wrapped in Irish linen. But this was the Spitfire of its day and was key to winning the war in the air. Almost 6,000 were built during the war, but today only a handful remain. When this one is finished, it will fly in air shows as a tribute to the men of the Royal Flying Corps.
My granddad was in 46 Squadron. Would he have been involved in the making or the maintaining of one of these planes that we've got here?
Yes, each aircraft had a rigger and fitter allocated, and each flight would have a coppersmith, so he'd be responsible for doing a lot of the sheet metal work and on each one of the aircraft in that particular flight in the squadron. So a very responsible job, and very much involved in this actual type of aircraft.
Well, it's absolutely fascinating to go and see the plane in its stripped-down form and how my grandfather would have really been working on it in the workshop. It didn't have any of the linen over it, it was just bare bones, and it just looked like a model aeroplane. You've got the great big tank behind you, you've got a little wicker seat, which you're all crushed up in. I found out that they used to go up to about 15,000 feet as well, so it must have been freezing cold up there. And when you came back down, you got headaches and everything. They had to put whale grease on their face. And that's before anyone starts shooting at you.
Matthew is travelling south from Belgium through France on his quest to find out how his great-uncle Albert died in a German prisoner of war camp.
What's really weird is coming over to France to begin a story of which I know the ending. And it's not a good ending either. But in a terrible way, I'm quite excited about it, knowing where he was, maybe standing where he stood or where he fought or where he, you know, or maybe where he was wounded or captured or... What was his life? How long was he here?
By 1916, Albert Nugent had managed to stay alive through 2 years of fighting.
He's moved on a bit now.
Yeah.
He's recovered from his wounds at Mousetrap Farm.
Yeah.
Historian Paul Reed has found official documents that show Albert has been promoted to sergeant. In the summer, he was sent to fight here, in this field, in the war's bloodiest battle, the Somme. On the first day alone, 19,000 men died.
And on that first day of the Somme, this photograph was taken. The official title of this is the Public Schools Battalion of the Middlesex Regiment. But we know it's wrong.
Oh.
And we know it's wrong by looking at these men here.
Yeah.
Now, you remember your photograph of Albert? He had a cap badge on.
Yes, he did.
And that identified his regiment, yes. The East Lancs.
Yes.
And if we look at these men, we see they have exactly the same cap badge. And they are 1st Battalion men, the whole group of them here. And because there's another one here wearing an East Lancs badge, and these are men from the East Lancs Regiment.
Could he be one of these men?
There's a very strong chance one of them is him.
Oh.
There are a couple of sergeants on here.
Yeah.
One of them looking directly at the camera, which doesn't look like him.
That's not him, no.
And one looking away from the camera.
Mm-hmm.
Who's got clear sergeant stripes on his uniform. And that could be him.
This could be.
Now, we'll never know for sure, but there's a very high chance that he's here. And now, 90-odd years later, you're literally standing on the spot where he was.
That could be him, couldn't it? Oh, wow.
Well, I mean, this is fantastic. It's the most exciting bit of it is, and now I'm kind of galloping towards the end now, because how much more has this man got to go through of this story before he gets even to have a lie down, really? You know, over 400,000 casualties in the Somme. I mean, it just conjures up terrible, terrible images. And the fact that he's there, and that I'm convinced that's him. I'm sure that's him. And I'm standing on the same spot. And that's my man. And now I want to know what the rest of the story is.
Phil is at the RAF Museum in North London. He's meeting with aviation expert Joshua Levine to find out more about his grandfather, William Tufnell, and his work as an air mechanic during the war. At first scorned by the generals, these flimsy-looking planes were transformed by William's squadron and the men of the Flying Corps into a vital new weapon.
And what we got here?
Well, what we got here is, this is wonderful, this is an A-type camera. It's encased in mahogany. This basically is the first camera that was used in the air. And it was used to take photographs of the trench systems. And this really gives a feel of how these men were making it up as they went along. Your grandfather was one of these men.
Handheld, obviously.
Handheld over the side of the plane.
Yeah.
You know, you'd have to stand up in the cockpit, the observer would stand up, holding this thing over the side of the plane. And in that way, they actually mapped the trenches by taking photographs at regular intervals so that they had the entire trench system mapped out.
Mm.
This is one reason why the aeroplane became more and more important. And here's another reason. This is a transmitter. This would be placed inside the cockpit, the observer's cockpit, and he would transmit down in Morse messages telling the battery down below how accurate its shell fire was.
Back to the artillery?
Back to the artillery.
Yeah. Left a bit, right a bit. So did people by this time now start realising what a force aeroplanes could be on the battlefield?
Well, they were realising the potential.
Yeah.
And I'll ask you the question. Yeah. Why do you think there were fighter aircraft during the First World War?
Well, probably to shoot down the people who were taking the photos.
Precisely.
Yeah.
And that was exactly the purpose.
Yeah.
To shoot down the enemy aeroplanes that were taking the photos and were doing the work on behalf of the enemy, and to protect your aeroplanes that were doing precisely the same thing.
Yeah.
And it was out of that that developed the sort of gladiatorial combats that, you know, we now remember the First World War for. And it was those gladiatorial combats that 46th Squadron was taking part in 1917 and 1918.
And Joshua has also found confirmation that Phil's grandfather, William, was on the front line with 46th Squadron during this period.
We've managed to find a Tufnell.
Yes.
Who is a coppersmith.
Yes, well, it must be him.
Well, we can only assume it is him. Here he is on this page here. W. Tufnell, 18709.
That's his number. That's his number that my dad said, 18709.
He was an air mechanic first class.
Yes.
And
what does a first class mechanic mean?
It's good.
Top. Yeah.
It's top. And here is 4 shillings. That's
4 shillings.
What he was making.
Not
so
too
so
bad.
Relatively speaking,
pretty
he was,
well
he,
off.
He was well off.
Yeah, he was a skilled person.
He was a skilled worker.
Yeah.
When he went into town, into Amiens or whichever town it was, he had a bit of money to spend.
Get a little glass of wine.
Matthew has followed his great-uncle Albert's footsteps through 2 years of war and 5 major battles. He had suffered shell shock and a gunshot wound to the head. But Matthew has yet to find out how Albert became a prisoner of war and how he died.
When I embarked on this journey, I didn't really think much about it, you know. But here's a terrible thing. I'm really quite excited by this story. I'm actually excited by his story. I want to know. And I don't know whether I should be excited by it. I mean, obviously, I'm appalled by all the conditions and things, but it's also a story about what humans can endure, what they can put up with, and it's a fantastic story, whatever it turns out to be, you know. Oh, and we do know what it turns out to be in the end, death.
On the night of October the 18th, the men of the 1st East Lancashires were ordered to attack a German trench, here, at a place called the Transloy Ridge. It was a disaster, and Albert Nugent was in the middle of it all.
I really need to fill in the details now. I know, and I keep looking at that picture of him and thinking, he was here. You know,
It makes it all real, doesn't it?
We're looking out towards where these trenches were, directly in front of us here, just below the rise.
Historian Paul Reed has uncovered some vital new information about Matthew's uncle Albert.
Not a single officer or NCO made it back. And what we know is that Albert Nugent was wounded here. And what we now know for definite is that he was also taken prisoner here. This is the spot where his war effectively on the Western Front came to an end.
This is where it happened.
92 years later, Matthew retraces his great-uncle Albert's steps across the field to where he was wounded and taken prisoner.
It's about 300 paces, and he'd have had all his kit on. 66 pounds. The whole of this would just have been mud, holes, water, bodies, barbed wire, shell fire, explosions all around you. And I wonder how long it took him just to kind of... At which point did he... Was he wounded? At which point was he shot? Or blown up, or... And then how long did he lie there? But then, of course, he didn't drown in one of the shell holes. He didn't die on the battlefield. He must have thought, what am I doing here? What am I doing? Why am I here? And of course, that's what makes it real, I suppose. Because you know somebody who was there and you start to fill in the details. And it becomes more and more terrible.
At the RAF Museum in London, Phil is finding out just how dangerous flying was in the First World War. By 1917, the life expectancy of a pilot in the front line was less than 2 weeks. 16,000 pilots died in the war, 8,000 while training in the UK.
And also, my dad said that they didn't used to give them parachutes, which I thought was a bit rough.
I think they probably agreed. And there is a communique from the Air Board from, I think it's 1917, which basically admits the fact that that we believe that by giving pilots parachutes, that would compromise their fighting instinct.
Yes,
in other words, they would be tempted to bail out.
Must be terrified up there.
Oh,
you know, you're up there in this flimsy machine. It could catch fire. You could get shot. You could get shot there. The thing just might break. Oh, my God, it must have been a refuge.
The pilots were terrified, and there's one pilot who he was actually a Victoria Cross winner and the highest-scoring British pilot, but he was so scared of burning to death that he used to carry a revolver with him at all times to shoot himself in the head rather than burn.
Matthew arrives in the French town of Epey. He has discovered from Red Cross documents that after being wounded and captured during the Battle of the Somme, his great-uncle Albert was brought here.
We're about 25 miles now behind German lines. And we know that this is a big railway station called Epey. Epey, the troops used to call it. And this must have been one of the old platforms. And this is where they used to apparently ship out all the prisoners of war, because this is a big transport centre, and I know he was picked up on the 18th. This way is where they were going to go, to the east, to Germany, into the hands of the enemy. He was wounded, I don't know how badly wounded he was. He'd be thinking these were the worst people in the world because of all the propaganda. That's if he was thinking anything at all. We don't even know if he was conscious. And he heads off up that way to Germany to finish his journey, his war, and his life.
Phil is about to do something his grandfather never did. As a mechanic, William didn't get to fly in the planes he helped keep in the air. But 90 years later, Phil has been given a rare opportunity to find out what life was like for the men of his grandfather's squadron. And it's not without its hazards.
Yep. No brakes on it then.
No brakes.
No
steering.
No steering? There must be
no steering. No steering on the ground. There's no steering in the air, don't worry.
Right, well, I suppose you better show me how to get in.
Okay, let's go.
Let's go.
Right foot. You can pull on the cockpit side. Left foot on the pad. Right foot in the hole. Throw your left leg onto the seat. Get this leg in.
Power on.
So you're standing on the seat.
Right.
Then you can put your feet straight down on the...
Okay, hold on. There's a few sort of like switches and stuff in there. Just don't touch anything.
No. Turn those off, it goes very quiet.
Okay.
Right.
It is possible for the engine to get rich and have a rich cut, which basically means it stops. Now, I'm not planning on that happening, but if it does, it's not a problem. We'll be over the airfield and we'll be able to just come back and glide and land on the airfield. So if the engine stops, don't become alarmed.
Now I'm strapped in, you tell me. Okay,
we're not planning on that happening, but if it does happen, it's no problem. It's easy for me to glide the aeroplane back down onto the airfield.
So if the engine stops, don't panic.
We'll
came up with a 1914 aeroplane. My granddad might have made the copper for it. Who knows?
Yeah.
I hope you did it well, granddad, if you did. Because your grandson's about to go up in it.
This is an original Avro training plane, as used by the Royal Flying Corps. It's the only one of its kind still flying in Britain. Nineteen Victoria Crosses were awarded to airmen during the war. Because of their heroism and ingenuity, a fledgling technology was turned into one of the most important weapons of World War I. And Phil now knows that his grandfather, William Tufnell, Air Mechanic First Class, helped to keep them in the air.
Fantastic. Oh, wow. It just, that's brilliant. I mean, it really takes you back what that must have been like.
Yeah.
I mean, and we were sitting there, lovely sort of still day.
That's
you imagine,
right.
Middle of December.
Up at 20,000 feet, minus 25,
people shooting
at you.
People shooting at you must have been horrific.
Yeah, yeah.
Because it's quite, you know, you're cramped in here, aren't you?
And the pilots would have been relatively inexperienced. I mean, the new guys would have still been getting to grips with flying the aeroplane, let alone trying to fight it or cope with the environment.
Yeah. I was thinking, I hope my mechanic's done a good job. You do rely. I mean, that's what my grandfather did.
Absolutely.
And I suppose that, you know, as a pilot, you just need that to be right. Otherwise, you're in trouble, aren't you?
Right.
Go have a gin and tonic now, please. That was fab. I can totally understand what the pilots were like when they said they didn't have parachutes, because that is flying in the raw. You know, it's edge of your seat stuff, that is. And I can understand why that fella said he had his gun with him, because he didn't want to get done by the fire. Because you're sitting on, like, the oil tank. You've got the petrol tank just above your head. You're surrounded by wood. The fuel pipes are just by you and everything. You know, one spark, one bullet, something goes wrong. Must have been horrible. Not giving him a parachute must have been an absolute disgrace.
Matthew Kelly's search for his great-uncle Albert has led him to Germany. International Red Cross documents record that Albert Nugent, a wounded prisoner, was transported 400 miles by train from Epey in France to a prisoner of war camp in the town of Giessen. There were over 160,000 British and 500,000 French prisoners of war in Germany. This camp, in Giessen, held up to 20,000 men, among them Albert Nugent. But the Red Cross documents also show that 7 months after being wounded at the Somme, Albert died here, in the camp hospital. Matthew and local journalist Utz Tim are on their way to the camp where Albert died.
I've got pictures of the hospital.
You have?
Yes.
This is
what the hospital would have looked like in World War One.
So this photograph was used in propaganda? Is that what you're saying? Or is this an accurate picture there of the way things were?
It's hard to tell. I can't really tell you. Okay.
Although Matthew now knows where Albert died, he still doesn't know how he died. Ironically, the answer arrives with research that started before he left home.
This is from the Manchester and Lancashire Family History Society. Dear Matthew Kelly, following extensive research, I'm pleased to let you know that we found the enclosed information relating to your great-uncle, Albert Edward Nugent, published in the Salford Reporter newspaper between 1960 and 1917. Right, OK. June the 16th, 1917. And Robert Sergeant Albert Nugent, 1st East Lancashire Regiment, died from pneumonia. Oh. On May the 19th, while a prisoner of war in a hospital at Giessen, Germany. He was 23 years of age. That's all. Didn't say anything about him as a man, but he died of pneumonia. Oh. So we know how he died now.
Phil has discovered that his grandfather and his squadron were temporarily shipped back to London from France in 1917 to defend the capital against a threat of German bombing raids in the first Blitz.
Well, what I've learned about my granddad, my dad always said that he was in World War One, but he never really told me what he did, sort of thing. He was in France, and then he also came back to England to defend London. Against, because people don't realise that London was being bombed in the First World War. So he came back with 46 Squadron, also to defend London, which is kind of cool as well. So I feel very proud of him.
William Tufnell survived the war. In 1919, he returned home to his silversmith business in London, where he and Susanna raised their family. William stayed in touch with his mates from 46 Squadron until he died in 1968, aged 75. 16,000 airmen were killed during World War One. More than 1,000 of them have no known grave, but in London, they are all remembered.
Well, I've lived in London all my life and walked past this a million times and didn't realise what it was. And it's, in memory of the Royal Flying Corps, and my granddad was one of them, luckily survived, but I'm glad it's here, it should be. I mean, you think of World War One and you think of all the guys in the trenches who died and everything, but there were other fellas losing their lives, so yeah, I'm very proud it's here. It feels close to me. I'm glad that it is here because they were losing their lives in the skies as well.
Matthew is also coming to the end of his quest to find his great-uncle Albert. Buried in Giessen in 1917, Albert's remains were moved after the war to this Commonwealth War Cemetery in Nidertsfären.
Here he is. 10831, Sergeant A.E. Nugent, 19th of May, 1917, age 23. And here we are, 91 years late.
this is him. One of a generation. But he's my one.
Albert Nugent is one of 1,797 First World War servicemen buried or commemorated in this cemetery at Niederswehren. Over 6,000 men who died as prisoners were laid to rest in Germany.
That was a journey. Privilege, though, to know what happened just to him, you know. Imagine if that story had been lost completely, you know. And it was nearly buried along with him because of the grief, I suppose. The grief must have been terrible for them. The only boy, you know, what that must have meant to the family and what he went through as well. And it's sort of representative, you know, as well, of that war. You know, lest we forget. We shouldn't forget, you know.
If you want to share or discover more about your family's World War I story, log on to bbc.co.uk/remembrance, where you can also find details about free BBC Remembrance events taking place across the UK.
Eamon Holmes and Kate Silverton investigate their family's role in World War I. That's tomorrow night at 10:45 here on BBC One.